This video is an example of the Central Limit Theorem. Thompson & Thompson is a steel bolts manufacturing company. Their current steel bolts have a mean diameter of 145 millimeters and a variance of 49 millimeters. If a random sample of 31 steel bolts is selected, what is the probability that the sample mean would differ from the population mean by greater than 3 millimeters? Okay. What jumps out at me at this with this problem is the words here, sample mean. I know this is not asking for a probability about an individual value. This is asking for a probability about a sample mean. So our random variable in this case is x bar, not x. So that indicates to me that we are going to be using the Central Limit Theorem. So to summarize the pieces given, they say or they claim that their mean diameter of their bolts is 145 millimeters. Okay, so that's basically their specifications. 145 for the mean, so mu would be 145, and the variance is 49. To use the Central Limit Theorem, we will need the standard deviation. So remember, the standard deviation is the square root of the variance, so sigma is 7. We're also given that a random sample of 31 steel bolts was selected, so our sample size is 31. That's important since we're using the Central Limit Theorem. We want to use that standard error of the mean, or the standard deviation that's associated with the distribution of x bar. So the Central Limit Theorem says that the sample means will be normally distributed if the population standard deviation is known. Okay, so we are assuming that the population standard deviation is 7. So I went ahead and sketched a bell-shaped distribution, and under the Central Limit Theorem, the mean of the sample means is the same as the original population or parent population mean, which was given to be 145, but the standard deviation is not the same. If you have a sample size greater than 1, as the sample size increases, this bell will get tighter and skinnier, but it will still be bell-shaped. And the standard error of the mean here gives us a measure of that standard deviation associated with x bar. So the standard deviation in this case would be sigma, which is 7, divided by the square root of 31. Now I went ahead and sketched the bell curve and put 145 as the mean because it's the same under the Central Limit Theorem. And I made my bell probably a little too wide. Typically, the bell-shaped distributions associated with the sample mean are significantly smaller and tighter than that of the original population, if that original population is normally distributed. Okay, so they're asking for the probability that x bar would differ from the population mean by greater than 3 millimeters. Okay, so if I'm talking about a difference greater than 3 millimeters from the mean, then I'm talking about 3 millimeters above the mean and 3 millimeters below the mean. Now, because they want that difference to be greater, then they want the two shaded areas for the tails. If they said less than 3 millimeters, they would want the in-between case. Okay, but since they want that difference to be greater than 3 on either side, I'm shading these tails. Now the easiest way to do this for me would be to recognize the fact that the whole area under the curve is 1 or 100%. And I can find this in-between area very easily with my calculator and subtract out this in-between area from 1, and I'm left with the two tail areas. So I'm going to go ahead and use my calculator, but if you wanted to use your Z table, you'd have to convert these two scores, the 142 and the 148, to Z scores first, remembering to use the 7 over the square root of 31 as your standard deviation. Okay, so in notation, I'm going to find first this unshaded area, and that's going to be the probability that the sample mean is in between 142 and 148. So again, if you wanted to use your z-table, you'd have to convert both endpoints of that interval to z-scores first. And then you could go ahead and jump over to the z-table. Okay, so after you do those two calculations, then you'd have to find this larger area from this first z-score to negative infinity, and then subtract out this, what you could do is, I'm overthinking this at this point. You could find the area from this z-score to negative infinity using the z-table, since it reads cumulatively, and then double it, because these two areas are going to be symmetric because we're looking at the same distance from the mean in either direction. Okay, so like I said, I'm not going to do this calculation and use the z-table. I think it's easier to use the calculator's normal CDF function. I'm going to find this in-between case and then subtract that from 1, because I don't want this unshaded area. I want the two outer tails. All right, so going to my calculator, I want to go to my distribution menu. At this point in the semester, you should be comfortable with your normal distribution. I'm going to select normal CDF. My lower bound in this problem is 142. My upper bound is 148. The mean is 145. Now, since I'm using the central limit theorem, I'm not going to put in 7 for the standard deviation. I'm going to put 7 over the square root of 31, that standard error of the mean. And I didn't have to find that first and round. I could put in the standard error of the mean in a fraction form right here. So that ensures that my answer is as accurate as possible. Okay, and then enter. So this 0.982976 carried out pretty far is not the final answer. It is the area between the two shaded tails, and that's not what I want. So I'm going to go ahead and subtract that answer from 1. Okay, so the outer two tails, the two areas together, is 0.0170 if I wanted to round to 4. Now that's a pretty small area. Okay, so if I divided that in half, okay, one tail would only have about 0.01 rounded to 2 decimal places amount of area, very small. So that reaffirms the fact that I didn't really draw this proportionally correct, but if I drew it too skinny, we wouldn't be able to see what was going on. Okay, so as a manufacturer, you might be concerned with whatever you're making, and in this case steel bolts, to be either too large or too small, and you want to know that probability. What is the probability that that's going to happen? So if they repeatedly took batches of the same sample size, they could accurately assess that probability.